We will be doing part 7 of our Semislav series here, so that's pretty exciting. We got a very exciting one because we're still on the Botvinnik. We're going to look at the main lines. I thought we would actually, cover all the rest of the Botvinnik in this one, but, we're taking it slow, we're taking it easy. We're just going to look at the 16 rook to b1 lines, and then we'll look at the main line next week. So that'll be 8, and then hopefully the Moscow and anti-Moscow will be parts 9 and 10, 10-part series. That sounds pretty good, but knowing me, it could still end up being a 20-part series. You never know. But we'll return to the Semislav. This is what we've been looking at for a good long while. And we're still focusing on the lines with bishop to g5. Again, a very sensible move. You get the bishop outside of the pawn chain, and if black does nothing, white plays e3 with a great game. We will look at h6 in the coming weeks, but tonight we're still looking at what happens when we take on c4, and we get some of these really sharp lines, some of the best lines in all of chess. Okay, e4, right? And now we have to protect our c-pawn, and e5. So we kind of went over this last time, so hopefully we all know how to get out of this pin. What move does black play here? So bishop to e7 is a slight mistake because your knight's hanging. So this wins for white. So yeah, you have to be careful. Right? It's kind of tough. You're in a pin here. So what move do you have to play? H6. Okay, so h6. Mm-hmm. And then white maintains the pin. g5. So now we're hoping your bishop moves away or... But they take. So now when we take back, we gave up a piece, but we're going to get this guy back. And as white, we normally just wait to take that knight until the queen moves away. And the way we're going to end up developing in these lines is white is going to put his bishop on this nice long diagonal. And he's going to castle this way in almost all cases. And black, he's going to develop his pieces. The knight's going to go to d7, the bishop's going to go to b7, queen to b6, and we're going to castle on the queen side. This is the typical scheme that we're going to see. So knight b to d7. So if you take with the bishop, we can take back with another knight. So g3. There's a couple different transpositions, but we're just going to try to get right to it tonight. So we put our bishops on the long diagonal, queen b6. And there was a game here at the club, I forget, it was a long time ago, but somebody had this position like this, and then I think white like castled or something, missing the fact that he could have taken the knight and should have. So black like went here, something like this happened, and black went on to win this game. So that was a funny game. So do realize when the queen moves out of the pin that that's the time to take the knight. So we take the knight, castle. And so now we've gotten out of the opening, and this is sort of a basic starting position. As you can kind of tell, it's a very unbalanced position. White already has a passed pawn, and he has a majority over there on the king's side, so perhaps he's going to, in the future, push all of these pawns. Black also has a majority over here on the queen's side, so we'll see in a lot of lines black tries to push his majority. And both kings often end up getting into little dangerous positions. You have to be very careful. And we'll get right to it here. So c5. And it's an interesting question, who wants to actually trade the light-squared bishops in positions like this? And often it's actually black that doesn't mind. So we wouldn't mind if they take here, for example. We can take back with a queen. And now we might in the future have some tricks. I can play some bad moves. Maybe I can play bad moves to make this trick work. But sometimes we're thinking when this bishop is out of the way, imagine he's here, we have these sacrifices on h2 where if the king takes, we bring the other rook to h8 and then to h1. So there's these sorts of tricks, and just in general, it's white wants to keep more pieces on the board. He's trying to prove an advantage. So d5, b4. And now the main move is knight to a4. But we're going to save that for next week. Tonight we're going to look at another very interesting move. There's actually another move. Does anybody know what it is? Also, at home, you probably do because it's probably in the title of the video. What do you? Rook b1 is actually the move we're looking at tonight. And it's like, how do you not move your knight? Well, if black takes, this is actually a well-known
the
mistake.
Pawn takes and the queen is under attack.
Okay, and the pawn takes and the queen is under attack. Okay. But I just move. So what's... Now, obviously, you wouldn't play rook b1. This wouldn't be a mainline top players are playing if there wasn't some little trap here. And indeed, there is. So in this position, we gotta... Do you know what it is?
I think you take on b7 with the rook. Yeah. And then you attack. You do a discovered attack on the queen with d8.
Yeah, awesome. Yeah, so we take on b7.
And we take b7.
Yeah, d takes e6. So now there's a threat to the queen, and we have the idea of e7. So if the queen moves, e7. And this is actually winning for white. Though I have seen this position, and I've seen people lose this with white. And around here, if you play in St. Louis, you should know this line because it occurs in lots and lots of tournaments here. So people around here, they play it a lot. So they always play like the main lines, and then people get to about move 16. People like to get to about here, and then they run out of theoretical knowledge. It's not a good opening to run out of knowledge here. So I see a lot of people get here, and then they start thinking and come up with some crazy stuff. But OK, so we can't take the knight. There's a little trap. So the move is queen a6. And now I will take your knight, because if you take back with a pawn, you don't get the tempo on my queen. So you're not forced to move the knight. And in a lot of these positions, too, what's interesting is material doesn't really mean as much as piece activity. And you're always going to be able to make threats. And no matter what, both sides are always going to be attacking everybody. There's tactics everywhere. So lots of games, even at the very top level, they're so complicated, these positions, that it's somebody's winning, then the other person's winning, and it goes back and forth. Because you always have sort of counterplay, and you're never really worried about material as much as you'd be in a lot of other openings. Like, who's ahead here in material? The answer to in all these positions is who cares. Because they get so complicated, it's just all about piece activity. It doesn't really matter who's up material. People will sack everything, sack exchanges, sack pawns. Just have very, very active pieces. Because as both kings become sort of exposed, that's what's going to matter more. And here you don't actually move the knight, because there's nowhere really good to move the knight to. So this guy, he's already in a perfect spot. We don't need to move him now. You know, there's nowhere worth moving him. So what we can do as white, though, is take on e6. Again, with the idea of e7. Okay, and as black, we want to trade the bishops. It's very tempting just to take the bishop back. It just took it. It's tempting to take the knight with check. This would be sort of the same deal as before. If you take here, now I'm on your queen and my bishop has time to escape. So e7. And we take. And believe it or not, there's actually two moves here. So we're going to look at two moves from this position. Now we're at our first, this is going to be the main deviation in this opening. As you can see, it's very, very complicated. Hanging, 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 hanging. Everything's hanging all the time. So it is really difficult, and it really suits whoever the most prepared player is. Now, the most common move is to take back the bishop. But what's the other move? So again, this is going to require some more imagination. And if you're the kind of player that played rook to b1 on move 16, you might be inclined to play the most aesthetically pleasing move in this position. I'm not saying it's better than the main line. It's in this line, this whole line with rook b1, which is sort of made popular by Wolfgang Ullmann, it's known to be a draw. So I hear like lots of club players, and they're like, yeah, it's a draw. It's all worked out. But then they don't know it when they're over the board, so. Do you have an idea?
Just queen d5.
Yeah, wow. Queen d5. Queen d5. This is the move. So just ignoring everything that's hanging. Queen d5. And we actually have a pretty nasty threat. If, for example, we save our bishop, looks great. Black's actually getting mated here. It's like mate 18, mate 19, whatever. But really, you only need to find the next one or two moves, and you'll realize that white's winning here. Yeah, queen a8, and then I'll have to play knight to b8. Yep, and I'll have to block with a knight. Keep going.
Keep calculating.
Keep going, yeah. Yeah, look at that. Very good. So after we check, you have to block with the knight. Bishop f4. And remarkably, it's pretty difficult for you to defend here. So here, white just wins. For example, if I defend my knight, this looks like, yeah, I defend my knight. Well now, simply knight d5. And if we go here, so we're still protecting the knight, we can remove a dude, and when you take back, we can take here, and you lost a lot of material, and you're still going to get mated. Okay, and if, for example, you know, we go here, this obviously isn't going to work, but I block the connection, well, you're just going to queen, and that's not going to work for me either. So this just wins for white. So black has to be really careful, and this is actually a common mistake. It's hard to know when, as black, you should play bishop to d3. You really need to assess what threats white has in the positions. And we're going to see a game, a top-level game, where somebody played bishop d3 in a position where it loses. So we're going to see that coming up shortly. So it's always difficult, even if, you know, if you're a super grandmaster, it's tough. So let's first look at this game, just because it was played kind of recently, 2014. And this was a blitz game between Hikaru Nakamura and Anish Giri. And we're going to see that mistake. So it was a blitz game, so some mistakes were made on both sides. So they took, and in this position, Giri played rook to g8. The main move in this position is actually bishop to d3. And this is one of the draw lines that people know, and they just know this one line, it's a draw. And then they don't know, you know, all the other lines and stuff. So. But now this actually leads to a very interesting draw. This is the one that I think most people, this is the one people in St. Louis know about. All right, knight to e4, giving up the rook. And now we're going to have a perpetual. So it's pretty complicated. But okay, we're threatening some discoveries. Okay, and then this happens, and we make a draw. White actually can, you know, continue to plan for a win here. Sometimes he plays a4. It's, you know, supposed to be pretty good. It's supposed to not really work out for white, but it's okay. You can try to play on as white. But most games here, they just end in a perpetual. Okay. But, you know, Giri was in a fighting mood, I guess. So he played rook h to g8. Okay, the knight still goes to e4. And here we have it. So this move was played again, but white actually does have a pretty serious threat here. It's a little bit different now. The position is a little bit different. So after this, so far normal. Again, we threaten discoveries. And now notice, okay, we don't have this perpetual, but white does have a really strong move in this position. And Nakamura found it. That's it. Yeah, so if you take on c4 with the knight, you lose a knight. Queen c5. Very, very bad move. Because, yeah, I have two pieces that can take your queen. Okay.
Knight takes f7?
Knight takes f7. This looks like a pretty tempting move. It looks tempting. Yeah, because you're attacking my rook, you're attacking my knight. So, yeah, I don't know. I don't know if you have, this might be good for you, but this might work too. There's a lot of moves that are actually good for white, but the one he chose in the game was rook to e1. Just a simple protect my rook. You know, I'm getting closer to queening on e8. And he took here, which is a big mistake. And now, this is the challenge for the class. Can you play better than Nakamura? So he played, you know, he won this game, but he actually missed something pretty simple when you have enough time. What did Nakamura miss in this position? I think the class can play better.
The queen to b7.
Queen b7, king a5. So again, keep going. No, you're right. So yeah, queen b7 is right. Yeah. King a5, and then what's the move? There's two moves, I guess, at least. So it's actually mate in two, but it was missed. So a little oversight in a blitz game. Queen b7, king a5, only move.
And then queen takes a7.
Yeah, queen a7 is one of the ways to win. So I actually like this one better. Okay, this also is mate. Okay, so a little oversight. Let's see. So he did take on a2. We missed mate in 2. He took on f7, which also totally crushes. We defended the knight. B3, this is also a nice little move to get to play. And okay, the point is, if you take with a queen, you remove the defender of your knight. You take with a pawn, you remove the defender of your bishop. A very nice move to play. He decided just to give up the knight. Okay, and this loses, and now he found pretty good. So the next move is going to be checkmate. White pre-moves queen to c6, and wherever you go, I go queen to c6, and it's checkmate. So it's just an illustration where just even right out of theory, even some of the top guys can go wrong. It's hard to navigate some of these lines. Very difficult in blitz. So if you are playing this in blitz, it does pay to be the more experienced player. So if you're playing this all the time, you can actually win lots of blitz games because people make mistakes all the time. It doesn't matter what level. You almost always play blitz? All right, well, here's what you should be playing. Yeah, it's very complicated stuff. So it also really can improve your chess. It forces you to be imaginative. Okay, so we look at the move bishop takes e7 here. That was the Nakamura Giri game. I do want to look at one more move because I think these lines with queen d5 are very interesting. Rook e8. And I want to look at a game between Spartak Grigorian and Alexei Shirov that was played 2016. So I was going to say this year, but it's not that year anymore. Yes. Yeah, that's fine. Sure. Yeah, take some pictures. Let's see. And yeah, so this is Shirov is actually a good person to watch. When you want to watch games in this opening, oftentimes it's good to kind of have a guide for certain openings. He's one of the leading experts on this. So Shirov really knows what he's doing. So, you know, if you're playing Shirov, maybe don't play this line against him. But his games are really good to watch because he's done a lot of work on these lines. He's come up with all sorts of improvements in lots of different lines. Watch lots of Shirov games in these games. And also, they're really good games. All of the games are exciting. It's like a guarantee because you played the sharpest opening ever. Okay. So he just played rook to e8. Now knight e4. Okay, so again, we have moves like knight to d6 coming. And probably at least some of this here was preparation. But here he played bishop to h6. And knight d6 is coming. First, he takes the bishop. And knight d6. And what's the assessment here? Has black just blundered? So on either king move, I take on e8, and I have this passed e-pawn looking fantastic. What's going on here? Take the knight and then save the bishop, which is what's going to happen. So he takes the knight. And then who's up material here? I don't know, probably black. But that doesn't matter. His pieces are going to be more active. For example, I get this free move. Okay, and that also makes e7 a little bit weaker after the queen moved away. We save the bishop. And so you can see black's really, his pieces are a lot more active. Over the next few moves, I want to make sure that I pick up your e-pawn, make sure my king is pretty safe, and eventually I got this 4-on-2. And okay, from the other perspective, I got to worry about this, but my pieces are a lot better coordinated. So here black is just better. And in this position, Rook e1 was played, which is inaccurate. What white actually should do here is throw in this check, which would kind of restrain some of these pieces. The knight's in a pin, and only now rook to e1. The knight was actually really useful on d7, as we'll kind of see in the game. But okay, so he kind of missed that, and now Shirov takes this advantage, and he takes it all the way home. Now, knowing that this is white's idea, and that's actually okay for him, so if we pass, white plays queen to a8. It's probably fine for white.
Yeah, so
how do we prevent that?
Plays,
knight to b6. So knight to b6 seems pretty tempting, but it does let me just take here. And now your majority is going to fall apart. Also, now I'm double protecting my e-pawn. Yeah, so here your majority kind of falls apart. So the knight is useful on d7. Which is why white wants to force it to b8.
Maybe just a straightforward king to c7.
Yeah. King to c7. Now queen a8 is in check. And okay, black just has everything. White tried f4, pushing his majority. He could have also tried h4. But here white got to, black got to play a really nice move. Yeah, good job, Mario. Rook e6. And it's a good move. Obviously, it sacrifices a pawn. But you'll notice in this position, you can take it. But if you take it, which didn't happen, the point is c3. And I'm just too close to queening. For example, let's do some taking and let's go stop this guy. I can go make this into a queen. And okay, if you have to babysit this guy and then I just take your e-pawn, I have all my pieces, I'm just gonna win. So in the game, he did not take. He decided to leave it alone. Queen f3, so I'm in contact with the bishop, which prevents c3, because then your bishop was hanging. Okay, just pick up that guy. Okay, and the white queen goes to a8. Do I have a perpetual? That's something that needs to be calculated. I'm just gonna try to get my last piece active. It's my only hope. Maybe I can find some perpetual. But what's really interesting about this game is even though black pushed all of the pawns in front of his king, white actually has very few checks. His pieces actually defend the black king in this game very well. So here's c3. And you can take on a7 now or on the next move. Okay, he took it on the next move. All right, so I'm two squares away from queening. You're trying to perpetual me. All I have to do is not allow that. So king to c8. And you don't have very many useful moves. There's not a whole lot of good checks. And this, for some reason, fools a lot of people. So I'll ask you, what's wrong with queen to a6? So far, it's fooled everybody I've shown today.
Because you're hanging
the queen. Yeah. Okay, too tough for the higher rated players, but you know the lower rated players, they can see king and queen in one move. Okay, and if here, knight to b8, and where's your next check? Okay, so none of these checks, all those checks are covered, and I push my pawn. So in the game, he tried king f2, he's gonna run his king in. c2, yes. Okay, I'm preventing you from queening. So you go babysit that pawn and let me do other stuff. Knight to b6. All right, h4. White's a long way from queening. And now black gets to play a move that's really nice. We'll pretend like it's the best move because it's the coolest move. Lots of moves win here. But he played the coolest.
Rook a7.
Yeah, rook a7. Look at that. Yeah, so okay, obviously you can't take here because I'm queening. You again don't have any useful checks. Everything's covered. And you can't go here because there's a mate in two. You can solve it at home, but we'll give it away. Mate in two. Okay. So he didn't do that. Queen to c3, still preventing me from queening. And I like this too. Yeah, you're attacking my c-pawn with check. That's cool. All right, I take here, threatening to promote discovered checks. So he did take. Just king b7. And you're starting to run out of good moves here. What was played in the game was king to f3. I don't know why you'd go to a light square, obviously. You know, you should go to a dark square because your opponent has a light squared bishop, horrible. If, for example, though, you try to check me here. Just king a6, and now no more checks. So it's funny. I mean, there's nothing around my king. I just got my little knight there, but everything is so well defended. Just all the pieces are doing the right job here. So he tried king f3, and then after rook a1, we're promoting. You can check me once again. You know, you want to check me once, that's cool. But then I queen. So here white resigned. So we saw it was a great example of the majority going forward. He wasn't afraid to give up his queen. He used all of his pieces. His pieces were better coordinated, and then he used his majority. And it looks so simple, but you know during the game it's really hard to assess these positions, and it was actually played really well by Shirov. So watch all of his games. He's good at these positions, the wildest, craziest positions. Yeah, he's really good at those. We'll return back to this position. Okay, black wants to trade the bishops. We get forked. We take the rook. So we had a look at queen to d5, which personally I like because you played rook b1, you're trying to play the most beautiful moves. Queen d5 certainly falls into that category, not taking back. But let's have a look now at king f1. Okay, this is the main line, so this is what you can expect to see the most. And we're going to look at another Shirov game where he played the move queen to c6. And here Shirov is playing a higher rated opponent. So this game I almost don't want to show you because the people played too well. There's other games where one side's winning and then losing that are more exciting. That's what really happens. But here we're going to look at a game where two people played really well for some reason. So queen to c6. This is that's Vanweli Shirov, 2005. All right, we're gonna do this. I'm also preventing you from putting a knight here, a queen here. Okay, a very good move from black. He took knight to d5. So saving his knight, protecting his f pawn, guarding against threats along this diagonal. Very good move from white. Now we take this pawn. And this may look like it loses time, because now they attack our rook, and we go back. So black loses a little bit of time. Okay, it's not just about the pawn, because who cares about the material? Okay, we got the pawn, and then we went back, great. But it is the d pawn that you took. This h pawn, this is always a guy that can be really annoying in endgames, because he's already a passed pawn. So we take the time, we get the good pawn, and now, okay, white, it's your turn. Queen f3. As always, this is, you know, the super combated diagonal. We want to protect it. White really wants to protect it. And we can kind of see how with the bishops gone, it actually is black that was happy with those trades, because sometimes something can happen here. We always have to be alert to this. Okay, so he gets his knight involved. He develops his pieces. Rook d1. So sometimes there's pins here. And I like what he came up with. He came up with a plan that is not so obvious. In the game, knight d3. Okay, b3. And the only reason you'd play this is if you saw this next move, which is not obvious, I don't think.
Yeah, but can't you do knight to b2?
Oh, okay. This obvious move, knight to b2. Yes. What do you want to do? Rook check. What? I don't. Okay. Knight to b2. And it's kind of like, what's the knight doing there? I mean, yeah, okay, I can like move my rook. What's your knight really doing there? And here, white actually played a very surprising move. I don't know if black saw this. Maybe he did. A very tricky move. Knight to c3. The trickiest move. I think a lot of people would have played, you know, just some move like this, but this is actually not good at all. Yeah, the queen is under attack. So yeah, black doesn't have time to grab this guy. We'll show it for some reason. Because the queen is hanging. Okay, excellent. So it's tricky. What's going on? And I do want to challenge you to give me an assessment, so at home you can pause and try to figure this out. What's going on here? Is black blundered? Is black winning? Is it equal? And you know, over the board, it's very difficult. You know, this is why you play it. It's really complicated. What is going on here? Right, yeah, so this is one of the points. If you take the queen here, okay, you gotta take the queen back. And if you grab the rook, we grab the bishop. So this is, yeah, one of the key points. So we can't do that. That's important to rule out. Can't grab the rook, you can't trade the queens. I mean, what's left? Have we lost it here? Queen to d7, okay, this has been... Oh, king to d7? Okay, much better, because I think you're getting mated the other way. Much better, yeah, king to d7. And good thing you picked that one. If you go here, well, I'm pretty sure I can take here. Maybe there might be some knight check that also works, but taking here is pretty good. The idea is this. Okay. So that's why you have to go to d7. Yeah, there's probably lots of other moves that win in that position. But king d7 was played. It's the only move. And yeah, computer's like, yeah, equal, finds a perpetual, makes a draw, goes home. Okay, and you know, maybe some of these lines were calculated, but maybe white wanted to play for a win. I mean, why not? He did start with a check. Okay, so we moved over. All right, so he checks. We move over. Now we have time for our rook. Rook to e1. Okay, so now the position has changed a little bit. As black, we're still hoping things happen here on h1. And as white, what we really want is access to the e7 square. We'd love to play rook e7. It's guarded by a dark squared bishop, so white tried to trade the bishops. Makes sense. After c3, okay, my knight's protected, and mostly I'm passing in, maybe I make a queen. Bishop to f4 was played. Okay, you're going to trade the bishops. So black took. So now I got access to the square I wanted. In I come, trying to make inroads to your king. And it's funny, yeah, you think there's only one safe square. What's funny is, I think like every king move is fine, but some are easier to play than others. So I'll give you guys two options. We'll kind of rule this guy out because we can take with check, though the computer will still draw this. Would you guys go for activity or safety? Really, it's about calculation. And a lot of these positions, you can't just like, oh, I want to play safe or I want to play aggressive. It's always about calculation. You know, these lines are very concrete, very tactical, and require, you know, a pretty deep understanding. You just have to be able to calculate. So you can actually play here, which wasn't played in the game. And then it forces white to find an only move. But then if you find it, it becomes hard to play with black, but there's a super computer-ish draw. Computer will draw anything. Can't move the knight, otherwise he's going to checkmate you. I mean, okay. Right, yeah, so the knight kind of has to stay in d5 in most lines. But as white, you actually have this move. Kind of hard to find, but queen e4. Threatening to take on b4, discover checks, taking your queen. So you can protect the queen, and then there's some like super computer draw. I guess it might still be in here. Do I still have it in here? There's like some super... There's a whole bunch of like super computer lines, and it's like equal. No big deal. Okay. But it actually can become quite hard to play as black. In the game, he just went to a8. Okay, it's also very reasonable. And still, queen to e4. Yeah, so I'm threatening some discoveries. You know, I can go here, for example. Go here. I got some discovery ideas. So he protects the queen. What good will it do if my guy's protected? Are you looking at this one or which one? This one? The other one? Okay, so we'll see what good it does when I protect my queen. Okay, that's what it does. When you protect your queen, you protect your queen. So he actually took here. And what's funny is, this is a pawn structure that's been played in more than one game. There's actually a game between Varakobian and Ray Robson. I was tempted to show that because that's an awesome game. You can go look it up. But, you know, we like Var, so we won't tell you the result of that game. But a very good game. And you said Ray Robson was just here yesterday, so he's just hanging out. Okay. So, yeah, both are nice guys. You can check out that game. Okay, first let me go make a queen. And if you take here, you actually lose. So you can't take right away. You have to be careful here. Now my queen is just too active, and I'm threatening this, and you don't have a good way to stop me. And no way. That's just too much open space around your king. Okay, so we go back. And white tossed in knight to c7. Which was kind of your idea. And now when he takes with the rook, now we're not on the 8th rank, so it's hard to play rook g8. And now he took the pawn. I'm losing material? Well, I'm up that knight. White's going to win that knight back, but you take the time to do it. And I really like what black did here. There's, you know, plenty of moves you could play in this position. But I like this one. Rook c8. I don't want to trade rooks. I want to play rook g8. You stopped me, now I'm going to go back. So he took. And there's quite a lot of lines, but He went here, threatened checkmate. Obviously, okay. Yeah, you can't go to f1 though. Just queen f3, right? And just. So I'm gonna play rook h1. So that doesn't quite work. See, there is an only move, but it's not that one. Yeah, you do have to somehow prevent this mate. F3. Yeah, only move. Well, the idea now is it's a little bit different. Because now there's no F pawn in my way, so I can trade the queens. And then it becomes good for white. If you don't checkmate me, it's good because I'm taking your F pawn, and this actually would be quite good for white. Can't take play. In which position? Right here? Okay, you want to go rook to g8 here? Okay, so I'll move. And I mean, it's probably playable, but I don't think you have anything too devastating here as black. The king is probably safer on f2, so maybe you don't want to give me there. Instead in the game, queen d5. Staying on this nice diagonal. Okay, I protected this. Maybe I infiltrate this way. If your queen moves, maybe I have this check. Maybe I can swing over here. Okay, all in all, a very good move. So he prevents the check on d1 and gives me this check. And so this is move 40. So after rook to g8, now the players have a little bit more time. And it's right after the time control that white actually blunders. So there's really only one mistake in this game, which is, it was very complicated, so that's actually quite incredible. But one mistake and the game came to an end. Okay, king h3, which is fine. Rook h8. And white, I guess, is not happy with the draw. He can go back and repeat. But he played rook g4, which is a mistake. So I guess he just missed black's reply, which is kind of strange because it's move 42, so you reach the time control and then you made a mistake. What is it? Rook g1? Queen g1 is the move, yeah. And now you're getting mated. Do you see the follow-up?
Mm-hmm. Rook to h5.
Yeah, rook to h5. Let's see, was that rook to h5? And then checkmate. Yeah, checkmate. Yeah, so running his king up wasn't right. He got checkmated. He had to just stay back home, and this wouldn't have happened. But again, it's just a good example of how complicated it can get. Hopefully you guys watch a lot of Shirov games. He's really an expert in these lines. Hopefully you give these a try. We're going to keep doing the Botvinnik next week. We're going to look at the main lines. So hopefully you guys can all come back and check it out because it's even more exciting stuff. So until then, hit like, share, subscribe, and see you guys next week.